where you can see Okay.
It doesn't.
Feel like I'm at a Pink Floyd concert.
Put a strobe light in here in a while.
Sound like a road run.
Hey, Larry. Lawrence.
Good to go?
Do we have anybody on Zoom?
So your presentation spot, okay, so you click on these, will show up on that screen.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, that one.
Go ahead and entertain comments in from the applicant.
Okay, that's working.
Yeah,
we're all good. Right. Afternoon, and I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to address the commission in the support of our request to add us parking space in our East Hope location. I'm Lawrence Smith, one of the general partners of Razor Creek Marina. My brother Curtis Smith is the other general partner, and John King is an associate of ours whose knowledge and input has been quite valuable to us. As you have no doubt realized in your review of the material submitted, both in support of and in opposition to our request to add a parking space, this process has been long and, in our opinion, unnecessarily a complex one. I'll try to simplify and focus the commission's inquiry. I'd like to give you just a brief history of our little slice of heaven on the shores of the lake. My brother, he purchased the parcel in 1990 from a long time owner who, in fact, was a resident of the home before the dam was built, before Highway 200 was even there. They had a wood piling dock floating right next to the southern property line, not connected to the land. It was 40 feet offshore. He had a metal shed that he would haul a tin boat out and then paddle out to his boat that he stored out on the dock. Then when the dam was built, after the dam was built, they decided Highway 10 was no longer adequate. So the family was paid the sum of $1 to cut the waterfront parcel right in half and put Highway 200 in. So that's what happened. But of course, all this Kurt knew when he acquired the property. And that's when he began his slow and steady improvements. The first step was in 2009, when that old dock was removed, a new 700 square foot fixed pier floating system installed. That was all done with permits through IDL. And this new section was set more than 25 feet from the southern neighbor's line. Then in 2010, we've obtained our conditional use permit from you folks for our limited commercial moorage operation. And in that expansion, the new dock sections were turned 10 degrees north, so to give even more room from the southern neighbor, much more than the 25 setback riparian line. For this expansion, we're asking you folks to allow one extra parking space on the parcel, so that we can have a total of 13 moorage boats. And then that'll be it. That'll be as far as we can go, because we can't impede the line of navigation to go any further. Hope Marine has a structure and a breakwater, so they don't want us out further than that. And we're not going out further than that. In fact, with our plan, we're actually still back from it. Now, I do want to bring to your attention the fact that we sent a document on May 24th to staff that answered many of these objections that were just mentioned. They have had our revised site plan for months. And the site plan that was shown by Daniel, that's incorrect. That's not our site plan. And it hasn't been for months. And the fact that he's still showing that is incredible. I could click on it now and show it to you if you'd like me to proceed that way.
The one you provided in your
file. It's the one I provided right in the file, right? And the correct circulation plan that It didn't take much, but we angled the parking spaces instead of having them come straight to the right of way. I guess in hindsight, I should have done that to begin with, but it's apparently once something's in the system, it can't be changed, but I don't think that's the way planning works. So you're supposed to like kind of work with the planner and say, well, that won't work, but you could try something else. And we did. And it's one of the big reasons why we're here, because it does work. A picture is worth a thousand words. We hired a drone guy and we got our rigs together and his, and they're not just all little smart cars. They're kind of typical North Idaho, big pickup trucks and SUVs. And you can clearly see that the seven spots work and you're backing out. You're not having to touch the right away. You back in with your rear of your car and then up the driveway and out, which is the right way. You're not going to be backing up onto the highway. We never back up onto the highway. Double click the drone photo here.
It just says highway or right of way, or I mean, it doesn't just say highway. It says
or right of way. Right. So
I just want to clarify that.
Well, on my screen here is showing the picture from the drone.
Well, we've got it right in front of us.
Okay. Now the five objections staff had, we have answered all those, and that's in your packets too. Now I do want to also in advance go over the one person that will probably speak against us, and they had an extensive file that they have in here with their objections, but we want to set the record straight on that. We are proposing a total of 13 spaces on the docks for rent. The entire system, not 14, not 15, 13. Now, about the septic and water system not having permits, that is incorrect also. They do, we have them, and why? And Daniel Britz had them, staff's had those for weeks, for months, and they're in your packets. There was a time when we didn't, and we had to work on that. That was something we needed to work on. We didn't know we didn't have them. The system was put in like decades ago by Kermit Cabert, still a guy in the county, still going, and his brother did the install, and he thought he had gotten the permit. Apparently he didn't. We found out, and then we did the work to get it done. So it's accomplished. The line for fresh water coming under the highway, the line for the sewer going to Kermit's wastewater system, also the commercial access coming off Highway 200 down to our, so those permits we all have. And the tank placement permit, we have that permit also. And now that's in your packet. To give you a little background, the end of our current dock right now is 63 feet from the repairing line between us and the neighbor to the south. Their side is at best 25 feet, apparently not even that much, but it's definitely no more than 25. The proposed addition that we're going to do, we're going to go 20 feet even further away. So we're going to be 83 feet from the riparian line. It's more than three times the requirement. And so it's surely enough for even an inexperienced boater to maneuver it. There is sufficient room if all seven spaces are filled and God forbid an ambulance has to come down there, there's still room for them to come down. So there is room for a service vehicle. There is no bend in the highway. I mean, the bend is like thousands of feet away. There's clear vision from our driveway to the north to the south for 1,500 feet in each direction. So that's not correct either. As to the objector's objections, I want to just read this one quote out of the order from the Idaho Department of Lands. That's in the permit from the Idaho Department of Lands. It's on page 3, number 7. And this is, quote, as to the objector's assertion, the applicant should have to meet all requirements that apply to a commercial marina. The hearing officer asked the objector's counsel which requirements are not being met, and the objector's counsel could not name any. So I'm hoping that that will clear that up for you. With all this being said, we decided the best way forward was to make this appeal directly to the commissioners, pointing out these discrepancies, letting you look at the facts. We don't blame the zoning board. We could tell during their deliberations, because they were blindsided too. They didn't have the proper site plan, the proper circulation plan. They were trying to find a way forward to it. You could just tell from their deliberations. They had one suggestion, have new stamped engineered plans to prove that all the distances work. Well, it's a difficult option at this time. We can't find someone to do it. We're on lists, 18-month waits. And then we had this brilliant solution. A picture is worth 1,000 words. Get that drone up there and show you, which we did. The original CPU is for 6 spaces. We're only asking for one more. And we're trusting you'll approve so we can get back on schedule. Charlie Kramer has a spot on his calendar for us in the fall. He's got the steel put aside, and both of those things are huge in this environment going on today. So that's about what I have to say. I'm here to answer questions.
Commissioners, do you have any questions for the applicant?
Not at this time.
No.
Sir?
Yeah.
So just so I'm, so these two site plans that you provided, where did you draft those?
Those were drafted from when we did our original conditional use permit by Tucker Brown from a licensed engineer at that time. And then they were updated by us.
Okay. That was my question.
Yeah.
So you don't actually have, your more recent one is not something that's been stamped by a surveyor or anything.
Well, it's an update, and I'm the guy that updated it. And I put this on there in the little updated by Lawrence Smith.
I understand. Thank you.
I'm looking at the difference between the two site plans, and clearly you angled this parking here where it was, these three spaces were straight. But I noticed on that last angle piece, all you did was reduce the line from the original drawing where it intersected the ITD property line. All you did in your drawing was shorten the line so it looked like it gave you more space. That's a 20-foot distance, I think.
Yeah, well, parking spaces, I've been told, are supposed to be 10 by 20. Now, that's kind of the old standard. I mean, there's,
because you go down and use your drawing, this line here used to go all the way out to here, and all you did was shorten this.
Well,
line.
Right, but it's still 20 feet.
Right.
It was longer before.
And I guess, but my point being, at 20 feet, I don't know what standard vehicle length is, but that doesn't give you a whole lot of room without impacting ITD's property. So that was my only concern. I was trying to compare the two to see what the difference was.
Yeah. Well, see, that's
outside of changing the angle on these three spots.
That one pulls forward more. That part. That's
space. You guys have any questions for that?
Just a comment that this is an awful lot to squeeze into a small area. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Yes,
the drawing with the angle spaces is in the ITD encroachment permit back there. If you look at it.
So. Okay, so let's move along. The opposition have counsel. I see Toby sitting here. Assuming you're not here just because you're bored today and wanted to come out and have some fun.
No, I'm here to speak.
Just haven't seen this in a while.
Yeah. When I do this, is there anyone else that wishes to speak in support of this? We're going to open up a public comment. Then I'll get to you, Toby, and I'll give you deference. So anyone else wish to speak in support of this? Sure. Okay, if you can, you can go to that mic right there if you like and make sure you identify yourself for the record.
This applicant, though?
No, he's... Are you the applicant? Are you part of the... No, okay.
Okay.
So you got 3 minutes.
Can I go by 5 minutes?
You can. Okay, so you have six minutes.
That's fine. You can still speak.
Okay, for the record, my name's John King. Okay. I'm speaking in the mic.
It doesn't amplify. This is just for our recording.
Okay.
Broadcast online.
So I've got over 50 years experience as a code enforcement officer, as a building official. I'm certified with the International Conference of Building Officials and the International Code Council. I mean, I've been doing this a long time. I've worked in 32 different jurisdictions. I know how these things are supposed to go, and this thing did not go the way it's supposed to go. We were assured that if we gave updated documents to the Planning Commission before the zoning hearing, that those would be considered and given to the zoning board, and that didn't happen. It's just negligence on the part of the Planning Commission. This happened again with this presentation given to you guys. I mean, they went on old information that was out of date, that was misinformed. And we've seen the same thing from opposition and opposition's counsel. None of this is what, you know, applies to any of what we're doing. And a lot of it just muddies the water. It gets into the weeds in ways we don't need to be in the weeds. We've got issues that are not before you guys that they've addressed that were before other authorities like Department of Lands. And Department of Lands has already given approval and their blessing to this project. And they basically have said that, and this is true, you don't need parking space to have a marina expansion. You can arrive by boat. That's what they do next door at the floating restaurant and to the marina there. There's also really insufficient parking next door. So it's kind of odd that they would even bring that up. They park in the right of way. And in fact, there were signs. ITD came out and posted signs in their right-of-way because these people were parking there and they wouldn't stop. So they posted signs. And 3 hours later, they're parking in that right-of-way again in violation of the signs. It says no parking. But they parked right next to the no parking signs. We've got photos to that effect. It's just odd. There just seems to be some sort of vindictive behavior on part of the neighbors. I don't understand why. I wasn't there for all of that, but the way things have gone just shows that there's either ineptness or some sort of corruption that's going on in the planning department. Oh, my time's up there.
No, you have 3 more minutes.
So... Right, I'm seeing it there, 244. As Larry referenced, and contrary to the staff report, Riser Creek Marina has all the permits. Staff had received copies of them, yet seemingly ignored and didn't provide them to the hearing boards, including you guys. They're supplementary now, and yet they were submitted to the planning department repeatedly. That's not the way things are supposed to go. This planning department is not being run by the playbook. It's something that you all probably want to be aware of.
I just warn you to be pretty careful about making accusations.
Oh, they're all founded.
Well, and it doesn't really
matter. You're not here to discuss that.
It doesn't help your case.
It does not help your case.
You should stick to the facts at hand.
Okay, well. I guess saying that all the documents were put into the record, but they weren't available online or to the commissioners. That's basically what I'm trying to say with other details that are coming along. I did have conversations with the district engineer for ITD, as well as the district supervisor, and they said there's no problem with crossing the right-of-way to enter your own property. If you want some examples, you've got Kramer Marine to the north, and the east entrance of their property, you have to cross to get into their marina on a boat. I mean, you can't be, common sense just says you can't be, they can't refuse you access to your own property. And that's in essence what this Stacy Simpkins was trying to do. But I don't think she had adequate information to make a judgment like that. She doesn't have the authority to do that. I've worked with her on several different things. And that's where I knew to go to the engineer or the supervisor. And they said, there's no problem with crossing the right-of-way to enter your own property. And just gave you a couple of examples, like, you know, you can walk across it, you can ride a bicycle across it, and they don't seem to object to that. But to access a parking space that's on your property, they've got an objection to, and that just doesn't, it doesn't track, it doesn't make sense. Same with the access by water to Kramer's. Again, I'm kind of being repetitive here, but, you know, they have to use the right of way to enter their boat parking spaces.
Yeah, your time.
Okay. Like I said, I'm just reading.
Anyone else wish to speak in favor? Anyone opposed? We'll start with the council. Toby, go ahead and regale us, as I know you will.
All right. And I have Rick's time too, if I could.
Okay. Rick, I think it's 1 minute.
Yeah. thank you, commissioners. Toby McLaughlin, Sandpoint Law for the Hope Marina, which is next door, just to the south of this Riser Creek. There are a couple issues the staff properly pointed out. Number one, Bonner County Code requires half a parking space for every boat slip. They're asking for 13 boat slips, essentially, or 13 mooring spots, meaning they need to have 7 parking spaces. And there's just not adequate space within this property to have that, to accommodate it. Now, staff correctly noted that there is a requirement under Bonner County Code that there be a stamped and scaled plan. And that's exactly what the planning zone, the planning department, the planning commission had a problem with. If you notice, this is the same exact underlying map that was attached to their original conditional use permit. So we know it was drawn up at least 2010, since that's when the cup was originally issued. And all there are hand-drawn lines in there. There's no way to know if those are accurate. And it needs to have, by Bonner County Code, at least 200 square feet in each of the 7 parking spaces. This is just your own code. We're applying it here. Also, the ITD, as far as the information that we have, there are no permits under the highway. There were no permits to go or to run the affluent line under the highway. No easement. Maybe that's been provided to you. I haven't seen it.
Yeah, got it.
Okay. But in any case, what is not addressed now is there's also Bonner County Code 12-432. I'm going to read it. Off-street parking areas shall contain a minimum number of parking spaces plus adequate stopping or parking areas for service vehicles. So there has to be essentially an 8th area for service vehicles to come in. And as we know, you can't use ITD parking for our ITD right away for any of this. There just simply isn't enough. There's also no proof that any handicap parking is available. Now, switching over to the septic, even if you ignore the parking issue, there's no question that this proposal doesn't comply with septic requirements. IDAPA 41.01.200.02, subsection B, indicates that all marinas must provide shore-based toilet facilities for their users. Been no evidence that that's the case. Subsection A of that same IDAPA code says any public or private marina which provides moorage vessels equipped with onboard wastewater facilities, meaning mobile or houseboats, shall provide sewage waste disposal facility. In other words, put in simple English, you have to have a pump station. That is Idaho law in order to have a marina. The way they got around that in the first place was their original CUP application indicated they were only going to have two self-contained charter vessels. That's it. That's all they're actually permitted to have right now. Now, anybody who drives out to Hope, drives by there, will see houseboats moored there for the last several years. My parents live right by there. I go by there all the time. They're not allowed to do that. And into their current proposal, there is still no pump station. They cannot comply with, or they have not complied with Idaho law. And without a pump station, this can't be approved. Also point out, you know, if you go to their original conditional use permit application, I'm going to read from it. Very limited scope commercial moorage operation to provide two berths for two commercial charter vessels limited by their Coast Guard license to 6 passengers each. The very specific limitations of this proposal may allow PHD to waive standard requirements for a commercial marina to provide both a restroom facility and marine pump out facilities on the dock. So it was based on those assertions that there were only be two self-contained vessels that they obtained the conditional use permit in the first place. We know for sure they haven't complied with that. They're in violation of the conditional use permit. And in the email from Tim French from PHD to the staff from March 31st, 2022, his words are, they are probably already in violation of the original CUP. So I understand people come before the commissioners or the planning commission to try to correct issues. I understand that, but in this case, they haven't fixed the issue. They can't and they shouldn't have had mobile or houseboats parked there because those potentially could have sewage issues into the lake. That's why this rule's in place. That's why there has to be a pump out station and there isn't one. That alone is grounds to deny this. The IDL, I'm gonna just address that for a minute. IDL's jurisdiction ends at the water, as you guys know, and it's your jurisdiction that goes from the water up. IDL was dealing with that issue. So it was with respect to the parking, what it says is if there is no, the code that applies to IDL, if for a marina, if there's no county parking system in place, then they have a rule, which is essentially the same one, half a space forever, or half a, one space equals, sorry, two spaces needs one parking space, two moorage spaces. They have the same rule, but because the county code is already in place, they didn't have jurisdiction to consider this issue. That's what it was. If the question is to what specifically this marina isn't complying with, well, the pump out station is one obvious one. The rest of the septic issues on site, on land, toilet facilities is another. I think that's a, I will also, yeah, now that I have another 30 seconds, the issue with the neighbor, it's not vindictiveness. It's that the people who park or the people who utilize the Riser Creek Marina tend to park in their parking spaces, meaning the Hope Marina's parking spaces, and it's limited parking. There's that floating restaurant right there that's very busy. So it makes it extremely difficult for them to operate with their neighbors' tenants parking there or users. That's the only feedback I have, unless the commissioners have questions.
Do you have any questions for opposing counsel?
Not at this moment.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that wishes to speak in opposition to this file? Okay, seeing none, we'll go to rebuttal. Daniel, anything you want to? Oh, I'm sorry. Are there people online that want to speak? Hang on a second, Daniel. Okay. By the way, the folks that are listening online, make sure if you want to speak, raise your hand so we can recognize it. Okay, go ahead, Daniel. Rebuttal.
I don't.
Give me just a moment, commissioners. Share the screen here.
Hey, Bill. So will the applicant get a chance?
Yes. The applicant is that they are the moving party, right. So they'll have the last word before you guys can close public comment.
Okay.
All right, commissioners. This is frozen up. We'll just go on what we can see here. So back to the site plan. There was several versions of the site plan that kept going back and forth. At one point, we had to pull the trigger and send this out for agency routing with the site plan that was last submitted and move on. They had requested a continuance of their hearing, which we granted and reheard on June 2nd after the staff report was prepared. They had taken that information that showed that it was inconsistent with the code and tried to correct those problems. That site plan was not reviewed against Bonner County Revised Code at all, because that was not the site plan that was submitted to agencies for review as required by code. So we had to use this site plan last submitted and move forward to get the project to hearing. So that's why the site plan you're looking at that they submitted with the new traffic circulation, also showing the property in its entirety, has not been reviewed against our standards at all, nor has any other agency had the opportunity to review it. And
can I ask you a question?
Please.
In your staff report, you alluded to discussions with ITD.
Correct.
And comments, also pull quotes from that permit and from the right way. And it appeared from your report that in opposition to the project. Is that correct?
Not in opposition. They just had commented. I've got this in the slideshow. Thank you. And I quote, and this that email came through from Stacy. I think the end of July. So the ITD road right-of-way is not to be used for traffic circulation or parking. The site plan needs to be modified to show that the parking and business activity is taking place on the private parcel and not in the road right-of-way. I had forwarded her the parking circulation that we were looking at earlier with all the yellow lines. The new one that you're looking at there isn't. They've also proposed in writing to add a restroom or a toilet type facility on the parcel that does not show on their site plan that they submitted to the zoning commission in June. If they would just tell us what they want, what they really, really want on that property, they should put on that site plan scaled. They're still going to be required, regardless of any work that they do, because it's all in the floodplain, to get scale drawings stamped by an engineer and architect.
Anything else?
No, Commissioner.
Any questions for Daniel this week?
No, I'm just scratching my head. Probably for Bill and Daniel. So after hearing some of the things that Mr. Lawford said, is this CUP out of,
Well, that's not the subject matter I for know this hearing, but we might be, given the fact that it's been brought to our attention, it very well might be investigated now if we've been put on notice that they've went past.
But how would we even consider changing something? I mean, it's almost like they're trying to circumvent the possibility that they're not in compliance with their currency.
Right. Well, I don't want to commingle those two issues because that's not the subject matter that's before the board now. I think that you should consider the facts here, make your decision, and then we will, based on what you decide, then we'll have to take the next step of looking at this matter or not.
Okay. So I got a question for Daniel. Yes, ratio sir. Parking spaces for boat slips, is there a set standard for that?
Yeah. Thank you, Commissioner, and I did mean to bring that up. So they're required to have two tandem parking places that are both 10 by 40 each. So based on the increase that we see here near the bottom of the screen there, they're demonstrating that those are the two tandem spaces that they need to provide by code. So it's just not simply a 10 by 20 parking place that needs to be provided. They also required by code to buy two tandem spaces.
So for 13 boat slips that he frozen, he needs how many parking spaces?
He needs a minimum of 7 parking places, and 2 of those parking places have to be tandem.
Problem with the piece sitting right next door to it.
Sorry, Commissioner?
We have a major problem with the piece of property sitting right next to it.
Correct.
Because I count way in excess of 100 boat slips. And there's no way you're parking 100 cars boat marina property.
It'd be 50.
Yeah, I mean, half. Yeah, so the code requires a half a
parking spot for,
yeah, so
for each boat. So
this is another situation like what I did.
We're focus on the neighboring property for now. We'll...
I see a guy trying to scratch out a living, little piece of property that he's got that's become harder and harder to do with inflation. And the law is the law. I understand that. We have to follow that. But at some point in time, we got to look at the reality of things.
Hey, Steve, why don't we save this for deliberation?
Okay.
I want to give the applicant a chance to rebut as well. Anything else for Daniel? Okay,
not disappointing.
You have a chance to rebut. We and the commissioners do reserve the right to ask questions during deliberations.
We're going to have to hold on to this to get the information on.
Oh, sure. Yeah, you can keep it if you want to have an extra. Yeah. Well, thanks for the chance for rebutting. And first comment, I don't know why they didn't have time. There was plenty of time. And I know they're busy, but I don't buy it. But
I think Mr. Brady explained
it. He explained it. I know. But you've got the right thing in front of you. Now, they haven't had a chance to review it. It's too bad. I was hoping that we'd come in and they would have said that owed to their revisions that we were in favor. So now, as far as the pump out, we are going to do the pump out station. It's in the appeal. It's right on the last page. And we've already talked to the pump ahead people. We're going to do it. We're going to hook and have a private septic system for our marina. We are going to do it. You can make it conditional on your approval that we do it. And if we don't, then we have to, and we're going to do it.
How long has this been in operation?
Since 2010.
Since 2010, you still don't have a pump out station yet. It's 2022. There's something to consider when making that statement. So.
It had to have been part of the original.
Right. Yeah, and it wasn't. But now it needs to be, and we're going to do it. And the other issue about the folks next door, they have 138 berths. Right? So 138 divided by 2 plus.
Really, at this point, 100
seat restaurant. I know. That's
your file.
Yeah, here. I'm sorry.
Playing to other bad behavior. Bad behavior is never a good
thing. No, I know. But we're trying. I mean, and we're the good guys here. It's just there is a need for the deep water berths. That's what we're trying to provide here. These aren't like the little seasonals where the lake drops. You can't park a boat unless it's going to sit on the ground. But we're fortunate where we are in Ellsport Bay that you can put a boat in there and keep it in there all year, and it's not going to get wrecked, hopefully, by a storm because it's protected. And there's enough depth. So that's the reason that we're trying to do it right. We're trying to do everything right. You have the copy of our original conditional use permit is this page. And it doesn't say on this page that you have to only have the 2 charter boats. It's the word is limited scope commercial moorage operation. So that's what I have to say. If you have any more questions still.
Any questions for the
There might be something that comes up in deliberation.
All right. Then I will go ahead and close board deliberation. Yeah, I've got some real issues here. And since you wanted to bring up the original conditional use permit and looking at the application, it clearly states number 7, two boat skippers, boat pastures may occasionally be on site at one, may occasionally be on site at one time. I think you've got some real issues with your drawing. I see the modifications you made. That I don't have an issue with the slanting these parking sites. However, when you look at that last one on the very north end, all you did was shorten the line to try to create the illusion of being able to back in and out of a parking spot that without crossing over into ITD's property. And well, I'll tell you what, that person, if you have a car parked next to it, you're not going to get that car out without backing onto ITD's property.
Can I chime in on the site plan requirement? Because I think that Toby alluded to it as well. Right. It does say that there is a requirement for a site plan drawn to scale, showing location, etc. Doesn't say that it has to be stamped by a surveyor. But in this case, given the fact that you're dealing with such tight tolerances, there's another provision in the code. It's subsection L that says that you may, the governing body, require additional information sufficient to help you make a decision. Sorry,
I was getting there.
Well, in this case, I might recommend that. Also, remind you that it's incumbent on the applicant to prove that it is that the project is in compliance or in conformity with the comprehensive plan, meets the standards.
And so, where I was going before you jumped in, but thank you anyway. Was that I think we have a couple of solutions that need to be made here, and I'm a little concerned about the stamp that does show up on here because it almost looks like it was laid over the drawing and copied, but I could be wrong. There's really no scale here. I think this needs to be properly surveyed and represented to planning. Scaled survey drawing that clearly outlines how you're going to possibly get a vehicle through a narrow space without crossing ITD's land. Getting on and off the highway is not the issue. The issue is not that. I know it's been conflated to that to a degree. There is no issue there legally, but when you're having to back up and turn around and you're backing up and turning around, clearly on what would be ITD's property, that's where you run afoul of code.
I'm concerned about the letter from ITD.
Which is
what we have to deal with.
I'm concerned about 2010, there's still no bathroom, there's still no pump out. I mean, that doesn't show a good faith effort on the owner's part to comply with the conditional use permit. But that's something we'll also look into under a different matter. Go ahead.
So without mentioning the current conditional use permit, which I will, because it was meant to be a very small scale, tiny operation, and it's expanded beyond what I think its original intent was. And now we're trying to even expand it further. I have some real heartburn with trying to squeeze any more into what is apparently seems to be a very tight quarters by your own pictures. I mean, I wish I could see the line on your, but I got a pretty good idea where it comes through there at. And I just don't see how you can do all the things you're trying to do on this small piece of property. It just doesn't seem possible without going on to ITD and doing, and I mean, how are you going to cram all that on there? But
there's their guardrail, which should be close to the highway, but.
Do you see this?
Well, yeah.
Do you see this line? This is where their right of way is. And it says right of way.
Right.
It doesn't say highway. It says right of way.
Well, and if you look at these two drawings side by side, the one that was submitted by the applicant today and the one that we had in the file, the original submission, the quick differences are
the angle.
See this line? Well, these three are angled, but see this line, how it goes out and it contacts the right of way? And all that happened here was they just shortened the line. There's been really no change. If this were moved up, I don't know how you'd get away with having this one because the car is not going to be able to back out. It hit the car next to it. I mean, there's just logistically, this is problematic at the very least.
And I mean, we've got multiple maps, angled parking, non-angled parking. I mean, it's kind of a confusing thing. I think I agree with, I'm not even sure if I agree with demanding this because I don't see how you can do it on this piece of property. It's a dime sized property trying to put a quarter worth of stuff on it.
No, I agree. Yeah, I think it's a problem. And I think the applicant is well within the right to, if they want to get a surveyed scale drawing and get it back to planning for reconsideration at a later date. At this point, I don't see how we can approve this.
Steve, you're up.
Now you can talk, Steve. Go ahead.
It's a tight spot.
There's no further deliberation. I'll go and entertain a motion.
Well, I just have to find it, I guess. But...
Page 11.
So all we're doing is upholding or...
No, I see the denier approved. So they're appealing to change the CUP to add that parking spot. So if you're opposed to it, you deny. If you want to agree with the applicant, then you approve.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I move to deny this project file MOD0008-21, requesting a modification of a conditional use permit C925-09, previously approved for mooring operations in 2009, to include one additional parking space based on the following conclusions of law and found in the staff report. The site plan does not show sufficient space to accommodate additional parking spaces required for the expansion of the marina operation. Structures on the property are not meeting the required setbacks. Traffic circulation for the proposal is not meeting the code. The site plan is incomplete. The proposal is not meeting other state agency requirements. The decision is based on the evidence submitted up to the time of the staff report was prepared and testimony received at this hearing. I further move to adopt the findings of fact, conclusions of law as set forth in the staff report and direct the planning staff to draw written findings and conclusions to reflect this motion. Have the chairman sign and transmit to all interested parties. This action does not result in the taking of private property. The action that could be taken, if any, to obtain the zone changes, to file a new application with the planning department to meet the standards required by the Bonner County Revised Code, or pursue such remedies as may be applicable in Title 67, Chapter 65, Idaho Code.
Okay, I'll second that.
Here we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Oh, sorry. Roll call vote. Thank you. Aye.
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 Okay. So the motion to deny has been approved. Yeah. Motion to deny has been approved. And that closes that file. We'll go ahead and go to the CUP 30-21. And when staff is ready, it may begin. I'm still getting out to it. Pardon? Oh, yeah. Okay. We'll do that on each one. Okay. So on file CUP 30-21, Commissioner's call for conflict.
Commissioner Conley has no conflict.
Commissioner Bradshaw has no conflict.
And Commissioner McDonald, I have no conflict. Okay. Now, Daniel, you can proceed with
everything. I'm going to give my best shot, Commissioner. Thank you for your patience, Daniel Britt, for the record, planning staff. We're here to discuss the appeal of CUP 0030-21 for an RV park. These are the applicable standards for which staff report was prepared and reviewed against. The applicant is requesting a conditional use permit for a 20-unit RV park. The site located on the corner of Owls Welding Road and Clagstone Road in Blanchard. The site is currently vacant. The parcel is flat with timber surrounding the property. And the parcel is currently zoned R5. Background on this parcel, it is an unplatted parcel. It is 4.17 acres. zoned rural 5 and land use designation is rural residential. Access to this parcel is by way of Clackstone Road and Alps Welding Road. Both are Bonner County owned, maintained 24-foot wide travel ways. The site's pretty unremarkable. It does not contain any map slopes, wetlands, waterfront, streams. It's not in the flood zone. An individual well, septic, can be provided on this parcel. Fire protection is afforded through Spirit Lake Fire District, and power is serviced through Inland Power. So BCRC 1233, the commercial use table, allows for RV parks in every district with the exception of the Forestry 40 district and the industrial zone, as we see here. Meaning the design standards, in addition to those, RV parks are required to meet note 8 and note 21 of this table. So note 8 says that adequate fire supply for drinking fire suppression, as well as an approval of sewage disposal sites and methods by Panhandle District and or State of Idaho, must be demonstrated as appropriate. So the water will be supplied by an individual well. The applicant submitted a well driller's report indicating that the existing well on the property produces 30 gallons a minute. In addition to the existing well, the applicant has applied for a new well permit for this project. There is a proposed individual septic system. Fire protection, as mentioned earlier, is provided by Spirit Lake Fire District. So note 21 requires that the RV park have at least 25% tree canopy coverage and not exceed 25% impervious surface. The proposed site is just over 4 acres. The submitted site plan indicates that approximately 38% or 1.5 acres of the parcel has a tree canopy. This will meet the requirement of the 25% coverage. Approximately 1 acre or 25% can be impervious surface for which this proposal is meeting this requirement. Several public comments were received with concerns over traffic, noise, potential crime, sewage disposal, water, emergency services, property values, fire danger, size of the RV space, and dust. There were 2 written comments in support of this, supporting the affordability of the project as well as the proximity to their property. These are the agencies that were routed for comments. Road and Bridge, Spirit Lake Fire District responded, and we'll get to those in just a minute. Idaho Department of Water Resources, it's attached inside your files this afternoon. Inland Power and Lights had no comment. Idaho Department of Fish and Game had no comment. So Spirit Lake Fire District, in regard to the layout of the RV park, we require a 26-foot road for fire and EMS response. We require wildland mitigation, defensible space as part of the park will be adjacent to a forest and timberland. Consideration for access, egress, and traffic loading onto Clackstone and Owls Welding Road for the RV and the fifth wheel is up to 40 feet long. There's no water supply for firefighting in this remote area. IFC 1194 requirements for water supply to the RV park for firefighting would have to be analyzed and implemented, is their recommendation. I would note that the retired fire chief didn't have any concerns about suppressing a fire at all on this. Bonner County Road and Bridge commented an encroachment permit cannot be located within Road and Bridge records for the existing driveway at 1021 Clackstone Road. The applicant shall file for a commercial encroachment permit for the existing driveway, another permit for the proposed new driveway onto Owls Welding Road from Bonner County Road and Bridge office. Road and Bridge staff will inspect the existing driveway and location for the proposed driveway and notify the applicant of any improvements that are needed in order to bring the existing driveway to current county standards. The width of the driveway shown on the applicant's proposed site plan is not wide enough to meet the 30-foot wide commercial approach requirements and lacks the necessary 30-foot radii. All the identified work will need to be completed by the applicant in accordance with the Bonner County road standards for the existing and new driveways. The proposed site plan shows stop sign at each driveway entrance. These Stop signs are optional at private driveways, and their maintenance will be the sole responsibility of the applicant. Additional information that the zoning commissioner requested for this proposal was Idaho Department of Water Resources. They were looking for any permitting that may be required for the delivery of water, how it may or may not affect the aquifer, what type from Panel of Health, they wanted to know what type of septic system and drain field requirements are needed for the proposal. Spirit Lake, the applicant was asked to reach out to them, why the fire district is requiring the 26-foot wide travel way for the proposal, and where that 26-foot travel way is to start and end. DEQ comments on how, if any, impacts of the proposal would affect the water for the aquifer as well, and dealing with snow storage. I think it's noteworthy that the Spirit Lake Fire Chief has retired and has been replaced. I reached out to the new fire chief and gave her the proposal, to which I never received any comment from her on it. So I don't know if she's so busy she didn't have the time or not. This is the site plan that was originally submitted to the planning department and reviewed against the standard for 12497. This is the updated site plan that addresses those concerns that the zoning commission requested of the applicant, and he resubmitted on June 2nd. These are some photos looking at the proposal and the property, looking from north and south on the corner of Claxton Road and Al's Welding Road. This is some pictures of that are on site, starting with the north, going more towards the center and looking towards the south. These are the conditions of approval as found in the staff report. These are additional conditions that the zoning commission had put on. The proper signage for directional traffic in and out of the park be installed. The water rights be approved and permitted by the Idaho Department of Water Resources. An approval of the septic system from Panhandle Health District, and the site plan submitted and adopted on June 2nd and signed by the chair, which he did do. Findings of facts have not changed since the time staff report was prepared, nor have the conclusions of law. Staff found that this proposal is consistent with Bonner County Revised Code 12.33 and 12.497 for RV parks. The Zoning Commission voted unanimously to approve this proposal. That concludes my presentation. I can take any questions.
I have a quick question for you here. Okay. As far as Road and Bridges concerns about the encroachment, specifically with the 30-foot entry and 30-foot radii, are those met with this new design?
I have no idea. We did not scale those out to find out if they were upgraded. It'll be a requirement of his encroachment permit to do that.
So that I just want to make sure it's captured, because I almost kind of feel like if we were to approve this, it should be at least called out in the conditions as well.
Correct.
Or not, because it has to do with their permit. So it's kind of a mute point. I was thinking about the same thing, and then I thought, well.
And the site plan can be amended based on this hearing. If you choose to approve it, they can amend the site plan to accommodate for Road and Bridges comment.
Okay. I want to make sure. Okay. Any other questions for staff? Hear any? So, applicant here, make sure you, I'm assuming you want to say a few words.
Yes.
So if you do, make sure you identify yourself for the record, if you would. Go ahead.
Hello, my name is Stephen Doty. Papers here. Yeah, I did commit to building out those driveways to the specifications of Road and Bridge. And we also went, I believe, an extra 100 feet back from the intersection with the driveway. So we're moving it farther north up Claxton Road to almost double the distance required from an intersection, just to help aid in less congestion on that road. I think Daniel did a great job presenting the thing. I'm not sure if I have much to comment. I could try to go through the appeal and make comments on that. I don't know if that's desired.
It's your time to do whatever you feel.
Or you can wait.
We need to hear. Or you can wait and do it in rebuttal.
Address it after you hear him, I guess.
Okay. Did you guys get a chance to read the appeal or anything, or not really?
Yeah. We read everything in the file.
Okay.
Very lengthy. And a lot of repetitiveness in the letters.
Yes, yeah. You can either respond to those now or wait until after we're going to give opposition a chance to speak, and then you can rebut.
Okay.
Which might be better. It's up to you.
I'll go through them briefly right now, real quick. Okay. So the main three things, the three items in the appeal were the term housing I used a couple times in my permit. They took offense with that and thought that because I used the word housing, that changed what I was building. That's item one in their appeal. Item two in their appeal says that the information that was requested at the first hearing on the 5th was not provided on June 2nd, which isn't the case. And I can show that it was all emailed in prior to the hearing. And there was even Milton, even for 2 minutes, discussed with the with the zoning commissioners just to verify that they had a chance to read that information. So that was all presented. So item two doesn't make sense to me. And then pretty much item three pretty much says everyone was incompetent and the whole thing was done incorrectly. So that's kind of a summary of the appeal. As far as the term housing being used, I use the term RV park over like 20 times. The reason I used the term housing a few times was because the permit, when you're filling out the permit online, it prompts you, how does this align with our housing standards? So that's why that term came up. And anyhow, and if there's an issue with that term, I'm happy to take that out of the permit.
I wouldn't worry about it.
Yeah, it's a grammar issue. Some of their points, they were trying to make a case that I was going to be renting spots like long term, and that was different than other RV parks. I've called Travel America, Cozy RV Park, Alpine RV Park, Quaint RV Park, all RV parks here in Bonner County. Out of those four, none of them had stay limits. I think Milton even commented that the last RV park that was approved, and we've had like 6 to 12 RV parks approved in the last several years. And Milton commented that one of them, he asked how long they were going to rent spots for, and they said they were going to do year-long leases. So, the idea of like a time frame on how long you're renting the spot should not be an issue. But I was going to limit it to 1 month, obviously daily rentals, weekly rentals, and monthly rentals. That's pretty standard as far as RV parks go.
All right, ladies, thank you.
Also, when I used the term housing, I said transitional housing, and I noticed throughout the rest of the appeal, the word switched to permanent residence. So I'm not sure where they got that word, but again and again, it says permanent residence, which wasn't something I said in my permit. So for item two on the appeal, all of item two is claiming that I didn't provide the information that was requested at the first hearing. I didn't require it at the second hearing. That's what the whole item is. So I went on YouTube and I watched, I took a screenshot at June 2nd, between minute 6.5 and 8.5, this was the slide showing the additional information that was requested. And Milton, like I said, talked to everyone, making sure they had received the email that was sent in advance, making sure they had a chance to look through it. And then I went on to answer all this. It stayed on the screen for a good portion of that hearing. and I went through all of these documents and satisfied everyone, and that's why they approved it unanimously. And I do have a copy of the email that was sent in prior to the hearing, talking about all those specific issues, and attached all the other documents that were requested at that first hearing. So this is the email I sent to Daniel prior to the hearing, and he sent out to everyone. So item two is pretty much just doesn't make sense. Yeah, like I said, item three in the appeal pretty much says everyone is incompetent. It says no one did the job. No one got adequate information. You know, it's interesting they say that because they even cite the code that says that there has to be at least one public hearing. And we had two lengthy public hearings. So the idea that we didn't provide enough information, or we didn't like dive into the facts well enough, is kind of bogus. We did double what the code requires as far as public hearings, which is stated on page 7 of their appeal. They state the code saying one public hearing is required. So many bogus things in here. They say that there was no light plan was submitted. That's number 13. And it's actually addressed twice in my permit, lights. They're trying to claim that I didn't address lighting and that I could put up lights anywhere on the property, overflowing into the neighbors' properties. I clearly twice in my application address lighting, saying I'll only put it at the entrances, so not to bother or affect any neighbors. So like half the stuff in here is just really, like somebody didn't read through the stuff well. Okay, on page 8 of the appeal, they say the staff report does not mention the 40 plus letters received that are in opposition by the neighbors. So they clearly say that the staff report does not show the 40 letters. And if you go to May 5th on YouTube, 8 minutes and 48 seconds, you can see 40 plus comments, just like Daniel presented again today. He did present it, he even verbally says it. This is the second, which he says over 40 letters, and he lists all of the complaints. So like I can go through and debunk these all individually, but it's just full of repeating things that aren't true, just throwing a bunch of stuff and seeing what sticks, more or less, approach. They're saying I didn't provide proof that of the wells gallons per minute. Anyhow, it's a bunch of repetitiveness saying I didn't provide everything that I did provide.
I think for our sake, we've looked at this and we've also compared it to the letters.
Mm-hmm.
So we know that you provide, or at least I know, you're on the right track. I know okay. that you provided those things. And if I didn't feel like I've been provided with that information, we can ask that question.
But okay.
Awesome. I know you're speaking to the audience, but we're aware of, you know, we yes. got both sides of the file. So we read.
Perfect. Okay. I'll move on. So just to point out, like, I'm trying to like improve the neighborhood, bring up the area, help the community, support my family. This is a very positive thing. But just to give an idea of what the property looked like when I bought it, I mean, I can just briefly like show the inside building. This is the property. I've taken over 50,000 pounds of debris off this property, and I'm not doing it. Okay, wow. I spent all of last summer.
Wait a minute, look at that boat.
I spent all of last summer hauling debris off of this property, literally over 50,000 pounds. Okay, so I'm improving the neighborhood to the worst property on Clagstone. Maybe there's one on Ellsworth Welding Road that takes the cake, but on Clagstone, I think this was the worst one. And then I even put up a beautiful sign showing the beautiful RV park coming. It was stolen. There's the police report number if you want to look up the police report. And then this is the type of flyer that's presented by my opposition, like totally trying to bash and make my project look like a bad thing. Like just total like propaganda. There was so much
misinformation in the first report. This is the sign that was stolen. I hadn't hung this one back up, but this is what I'm trying to build. You know, a beautiful place to, this would bring property values up again. This is supporting our local industries. This is a small business. It's even each spot funds a kid in Kenya. Literally, there's 20 spots here. We have fund 20 more kids in Kenya. Right now we're at 8 kids with other properties.
With that, maybe I'll open it up for questions if that's okay. Do you have any questions or thoughts? Or?
All of us have read through all these and I actually kind of agree with your position. I have a hard time stomaching some of the opposition to this based on some of the things they fabricated, but they focus on one thing. It's year round RV living. I own an RV.
Mm-hmm.
I stay in RV campsites like this.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you can expand a little bit more on what year round means, because I know.
So,
what it means,
yeah,
but I think a lot of people that are touting that as being the issue either don't own an RV or don't understand it.
I was one of only three people that showed up at the hearing back in 2019 where these codes were being written, and they were hashing out all these issues, whether like, should they put term limits on them? Should they, you know, all of these issues. And they ultimately decided not to put term limits or stay limits on the RV parks. And like I mentioned, I've called four RV parks. I tried calling six, two of them didn't answer, but the four I got a hold of were open year round and did not have a stay limit on how long you could stay at the park.
Well, in addition, there are RV parks, if you don't mind me helping out here, but only because I know this. There are RV parks that close up, RV parks that close down during the winter because
yes,
the water supply is above ground, and so they can't provide water. That's all that year-round RV living means, is you have the ability to access the site during the winter and functional.
Yes, yes. And like Ravenwood, Jeff Priest built Ravenwood. It's a great place. It's only open seasonal, though, but he's right beside Silverwood. Silverwood closes down in the winter. So his business strategy, you know, he's only open seasonal with that park. Different, you know, it just depends. We have a free market. So depending on supply and demand, if there's a demand, you know, we'll stay open year round. I just want to have the ability, and the code does not have any restrictions on that. They could have imposed restrictions on that, but they didn't. And actually, to add on that, there were restrictions, not in the RV park, like commercial RV park code, but in the residential RV park
like code. The stay is 6 months. Yeah.
Yes, there was a restriction date. I think it was, yeah, it was a certain amount of months. And they took that out at the 2019.
And actually, yeah, Commissioner
Conrad. Oh.
We're well aware of it.
Okay. That was removed, and it was just changed to some different words to describe temporary. This meets all the code. There's nothing in here that's against the code. I think this is just the appeal is just an attempt to just slow the project down in hopes that I'll change my mind or something, which is not going to be the case.
So
yeah. So anyhow, with that, thank you very much.
Do you guys have any questions before you leave?
Dan, I'd like to bring up.
Sure.
Just the last file. Because this was actually appealed by the opposition, we typically let, you know, the moving party proceed first,
right?
And the most important thing is that they have a last one. That's the circle here. So, you know, in this case, I think that it's appropriate in order for the due process, right? Some of the appellants, the ones who brought the case, to give Mr. Semenko, if he's here on their behalf, sir, rebuttal the last word.
Okay.
To make sure that if they are the ones that brought the motion, they have the opportunity to present their case, hear the opposition, and then get the fact finder the last word. That's really what we're trying to recreate in this court. But that's
right.
What I would recommend that we give the last word.
So I'll rebuttal, right?
Makes sense.
Well, sir, rebuttal.
Yeah, sir.
Last word.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to open up for public comment. Anyone else here wish to speak in favor of this file? Anyone neutral? Okay, we'll go ahead.
Do you have anybody signed up to speak?
Yes.
Well, it's kind of whether they're.
Okay. What I'll do is, why don't I go down the list so we have some kind of organization for this?
Or you want Norm?
Norm's going to go first. But
I understand what Bill was saying. Comment and after the rebuttal, I'll
go. And you're going to have a chance. You'll have a chance.
I want you to have the last word.
Yeah, you'll have a chance to rebut after. Yeah.
Would it be possible to put up the slide that has footnotes? That'll save me a little bit. Save you all a little bit.
Okay. I assume you don't have a problem with that. I would, if he's speaking on behalf of a group, then I would recommend that we just give the time to let this argument instead of running that clock. Is that the case, Norm?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
You attorney truly hang together, don't you?
Well,
I'm just kidding.
It makes things get smoke.
I agree.
So this initial foray is 3 minutes, is that correct?
No, you can. You've got extra time.
Good afternoon. My name is Norm Semenko with the firm of Parsons Bailey, land use attorney. Grew up in North Idaho, currently have an office in Boise and spent about half my time up here in Coutee County, Bonner County. Represent the key Bonner County rural folks and some of the other individual would have been framed as opponents. Quite understand that when I hear that. You all live here. You all have interests here. Always amused by some of these hearings. I hear people label the opponents. Everybody has a perspective and an interest in, that they're trying to protect, and that's certainly what I'm here trying to represent today. So I wanted to highlight 2 points, particularly based on what I heard from the staff and from the applicant. Number one is this is either an RV park or it's RVs being used single family dwellings. It's one or the other. They're both covered in your code, right? So talked about and heard about RV parks under 12.333. There's also, as you well know, the 12.332 residential use table, not the commercial use table, the residential use table, footnote 9 provides when an RV is used in the same manner as a single family dwelling, such use is limited to a maximum of 2 RV dwelling units per parcel. So if this is going to be a single family dwelling use of RVs, then the proposed use is not an RV park, right? So we heard, I think, some clarification from the applicant today, but that's not reflected in the conditions of the approval that have been proposed by the staff. Just one example from the application, which was kind of glossed over, with Idaho being the, and this is on page 6 of the application under population, with Idaho being the fastest growing state by population and Bonner County projected to be 2.25% annually, the park will provide transitional housing for those migrating to North Idaho and provide a low income housing option for current residents who are combating rising housing prices in the area. You know, when my dad retired and they went to Graceland and did all the stuff you do when you retire in their RV and they stopped to visit us, they stayed at the RV park. And that's RV park. They didn't make it a single family dwelling for them and their dog to stay at as their house. This language from the application is clearly talking about residential living. A single family dwelling and supporting that, which is a fine goal, but it doesn't fit in 12.333. It fits in 12.332, which is limited to 2 RV dwelling units per parcel. So if this is truly an RV park, then it can't be single family dwelling such as portrayed in the application. The conditions would need to be very clear that it's for overnight and short-term stays. And the kinds of things that you have in an RV park, those are defined. RV parks are defined as not manufactured part of the appeal you got. It's right out of NAICS classification 7033. Overnight and short-term sites, those are stays, those are RV parks. So if it's an RV park, make sure, not just referring to a code section, that the conditions are reflective that it's not for single family dwelling. People aren't moving in here permanently as their home. So I think that point's very important. If it is meant to be for single family dwellings, and maybe we'll hear that on rebuttal, then this would have to be denied. It doesn't fit the definition of RV park. It would fall under the residential use table, and it would have to be limited to two RV dwelling units per parcel, which of course this is proposing 10 times that amount. The other thing I wanted to mention is on the water issue. So right here, forgive me if I get carried away here, but I spent a 29-year career doing water rights, being in front of the Department of Water Resources. So one of the irreducible requirements for this to be approved, if it is an RV park, get past that, is it adequate water supplies for drinking and fire suppression, blah, 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 must be demonstrated. So this is a burden on the applicant. People are going to live here, at least temporarily. They have to have water. I don't know if any of you have ever lived in a place where there wasn't adequate water, where you've had to haul water. You had to haul water to flush a toilet. You had to haul water to take a bath. You had to haul water to drink it. I lived that on Rocky Road in Coupon County growing up, in a place that was portrayed when it was sold as having a sufficient community well for all of the 5-acre lots out there. And it wasn't. Here, this has not been demonstrated to have sufficient water. 30 gallons a minute has not been shown to be adequate for 20 residences. The application, not manufactured by the protestants, it's in your packet. The application filed with the Idaho Department of Water Resources, which is just that. It's an application. How good is an application filed with you guys? It has to be approved, right? With conditions, and then actually put to use to mean something. This is an application filed with the Idaho Department of Water Resources, has not been approved, has not had a hearing, has not even had a pre-hearing conference yet, has been protested, so it's just a piece of paper. But on the piece of paper, the applicant applies for 0.2 CFS. Well, who cares? What does that mean, Norm? 0.2 CFS, 0.02 CFS is 9 gallons a minute. 0.2 CFS is 10 times that much. It's 90 gallons a minute. This needs, according to IDWR and the applicant filing this, working with the department, requires 90 gallons per minute, according to the water right permit application. You have evidence, and only evidence in the file, that this produces 30 gallons per minute. Sitting here today, that well is an unpermitted, unlicensed, no water right attached to a well, which is fine, but you can only use it for certain limited purposes. And 30 gallons a minute will be plenty for an unpermitted use of up to 13,000 gallons a day for one home with up to a half an acre of lawn. 30 gallons a minute will do that. 90 gallons a minute at least is necessary for 20 homes, even temporary or overnight or whatever, to be satisfied. You don't have any proof of demonstration of an adequate supply of water for drinking. This isn't to grow corn. This is so people have enough water to drink. You do not have that in this record. All you have is that an application's been filed for that says I need 90 gallons a minute. You didn't have the right to use 90 gallons a minute, and his well is only capable, it's the facts you have in front of you, to produce 30 gallons a minute. All right, so where's the 90 gallons a minute gonna come from? Now, this says, staff, water will be supplied by an individual well. That's correct. The applicant submitted a well driller's report indicating the existing well produces 30 gallons a minute. That's correct. In addition, this part's not correct. In addition to the existing well, the applicant has applied for a new well permit for the project. To me, that says the applicant has applied for another well to add to this 30. Well, first of all, even if that was true, it hasn't gotten past the application stage. But if you look at the application, which is attached to the protest, it only references the existing well as a point of diversion. It does not propose a second well. It's only the one well that produces 30 gallons per minute. So there's not been proposed another well. It would be good to hear on rebuttal if there is going to be an additional well, because if so, that would require an amendment to the permit application or another permit. And then finally, the fire protection. I don't get this. So maybe staff saying that it's not appropriate to demonstrate sufficient water for fire suppression because fire protection is provided by Spirit Lake Fire District. Maybe that's what staff saying. By the way, there's no conclusion here that says this criteria has been met or it's appropriately conditioned or whatever. But I'm not sure how this criteria 8, footnote 8 has been met. But didn't the Spirit Lake Fire District say there's not sufficient water in that area to put out a fire? I thought I saw that in this presentation. Well, if that's the case, then it's got to be provided by the applicant or someone water to put out a fire. The application that's been filed with the Department of Water Resources attached to the protest applies for water for commercial use and for domestic use. There is nothing in there about fire protection at all. Fire protection is a specific beneficial use that you apply for from the Idaho Department of Water Resources. So this is a long way of saying footnote 8 has not even been close to being met. Bring us a plan that says here's how much water is required to serve an RV park with 20 spots. Is it 30 gallons a minute? It's not. How much is it? Show us what it is and that you've got sufficient water for that. And without that, you have denied this application. There's not been any sufficient evidence that there is water available for people to drink, let alone put out a fire. So with that, we'd encourage the commissioners to deny this application.
Hey, Norm.
Yeah.
Have you had a chance to look at the conditions of approval?
Yes, I did.
Did you look at A10?
Put that one up on the screen.
Yeah, I can read it. It says water rights to be approved and permitted by the Idaho Department of Water Resources. Are you suggesting that that's inadequate and there needs to be a more fleshed out condition of approval?
Well,
that would allow for that?
The your code requires that there be
sufficient water.
Inadequate water. Where is the well? Where is the water rate and where is the well?
Okay.
To provide that.
But it is in one of the conditions.
That IDWR approve what? What do they have to approve?
Well, they have to approve the amount of resource that is being required by this project.
How much is that? Where is that in the record?
I guess that's between the applicant and them.
It's in their wheelhouse, not ours.
To make sure that they're all right moving forward, correct?
Mm-hmm. There has to be sufficient water for domestic use, drinking, and fire protection. The application mm-hmm. on its face doesn't even have fire protection on it, so you're asking that they get the application approved and filed, it doesn't even on face provide fire protection. So I don't know how that fire protection.
I think the applicant, there's a notation in the file about it,
We can ask the planning staff to see if they've addressed that sufficiently, if there's something else that needs to
be. Yeah, if the commissioners believe that conditioning something satisfies the burden of proof that's on the applicant, you know, that's up to you. I don't think that hits the standard myself. I think that's how you end up with a drinking water supply that's not sufficient for the people that live there. You know, prove it, go ahead, go do it, go put the RV park in, and the water supply never comes. I've got 30 gallons a minute, and I'm going to use that, but it's not enough.
But it's a condition before you can move forward that you prove that.
And we do this all the time.
So the water right would have to be approved,
right?
And sufficient to. And
with our sewer. We do this all the time. I mean, we aren't the water experts. We're not the sewer experts. We expect them to. We're saying that on condition of meeting all the requirements at Panhandle Health or the Idaho Water Right
and IDWR.
So you would need to make a finding, I suppose, that the water right that's been applied for, if it is approved, is sufficient to provide water for drinking and fire suppression for that 20 lots.
So
I don't see that in.
It's in
I don't
there.
See A10. Anything in the.
A10 is broad enough.
Yeah. Not the time for debate.
Yeah, it's really not time for debate.
I'm just trying.
And it puts the burden on IDWR, who has the authority. We don't have that.
Right. Well,
the burden's on the applicant to apply for the right thing.
And then, and that's in there.
Yeah.
So that condition.
All right. I'm happy to answer other questions.
Okay. Thank you.
Guys, have any other questions for Norm?
Nope. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Anyone else wish to speak in opposition? Well, when I do this, you might not. Let me go through the list, at least a little bit of order here. Dennis Walker, do you wish to speak?
No.
Okay. Jeanette, do you wish to speak? And those that come up to speak, make sure you identify your name for the record, just so we have it on the recording.
Oh,
it'll can just tip it down.
Okay. I'm Jeanette Walker. I live at 100 Tribute Court in Spirit Lake, Idaho. And my husband and I just recently moved about a year ago. And we love this community. We love the rural life. And I urge you, drive in there and see what you're dealing with. On the road in, Clagstone Road, it's hard to get in there from that 41, Route 41? It's really hard, and RV is going to have a hard time getting in there. That road is really slippery in the winter, scary. it's set up for disaster.
Okay, thank you. Josh Emmett, you speak? How about Priscilla Emmett? That person's got her name out. Marcia Stevens. There you go, Marcia. Now you're up.
Oh, my name's Marcia Stevens. I also live in the vicinity of that. I'd like just to clear up a couple things. First of all, staff said that Chief John from Spirit Lake Fire Department had no concerns about the fire suppression. I beg to differ. I had a personal conversation with him and Old West Hardware about this, and he was very concerned about that. The other thing I'd like to address is the prior applicant, there was some current concerns by the commissioners regarding the parking and the how tight and trying. Commissioner Conley, you said that's an awful lot of stuff to put in a small space. In the planning meeting, I actually addressed that design, and I submit to you that the same thing applies here as what you referred to here, that I also have an RV. I've had one for over 20 years, that the same problem exists here of putting all these RVs. Can you imagine backing a 45-foot fifth wheel into one of those spaces when a road is 20 feet wide? It will not work. So my biggest concern is the fire, especially in the winter. If these are permanent housing units that people are gonna live there long-term, they're gonna have auxiliary propane tanks. That is a humongous hazard if one of those or one of those RVs were to catch fire and blow up. In the summer, as we're experiencing right now, we had a fire last year, scared the bejesus out of all of us. I was within minutes of evacuating my home. And that fire department, as you all know in Spirit Lake, isn't all that big. And I talked to Chief John before he retired and moved to Hawaii. I'm a little bit jealous, but he told me they would have to tender and they would have to do a lot of things. My personal well on my property, I get 50, it was tested at 50 gallons a minute. I could not support that with my well at 50 gallons a minute. And if my understanding of that well report, because I searched and I finally found that well driller's report, if my memory serves me correctly, that well was drilled in the late 1990s. And I don't know if it's been tested again, based on what the gentleman was saying. It was tested again to make sure, in fact, even still produces 30 gallons a minute, because neighbors around there have told me that their wells don't produce as much because of the drop of the aquifer. So that's would be my comments about that, that this is a dangerous thing to do in that area just for the water and fire suppression alone.
Marcia, is anyone else that wish to speak in opposition that hasn't signed up? Go ahead. Make sure you identify your name correctly, please.
My name's Dave Burton. I live about a quarter mile down the road. I've been out there for 32 years, and I have seen this RV park thing take off about 15 years ago. Everybody started putting these RVs in. It was legal. They said, put as many as you want in, and they were doing it. A lot of people had 5, 6, 10, and it got out of control. So they went ahead and put a one RV per 5 acres. You know, that's what Bonner County did to kind of slow this whole thing down. And now they brought it up to 2. I've got 5 next to me. It's not legal, but Bonner County's dropped the hammer on them, you know, and they're starting to, you know, kick people out slowly. But it's a constant riffraff, the traffic, the dogs, the four-wheelers, you know, and people just, they get bored living in a trailer, you know, and they're running up and down, the, you know, the road and whatever, you know, it's, there's nothing for them to do. They're in this tiny little spot. And so anyway, this is just the beginning of a long road we're fighting with RV living in Bonner County. You know, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is a great little thing he's got going on, just the wrong area. It's not a recreational camping, like they brought this thing up when they passed this thing, you know, it was recreational. Well, there's nothing to recreate out there. We figured, well, shoot, they're going to put it by a lake. You know, that's where it's probably where there's no people living next to it. That's a lot of riffraff for all the families to live out there. And these 20 acre pieces, they're all busting them up into fives. This is just the beginning of a lot of trouble. And this is like the beginning of this whole RV fight that we're starting, because it's just not working out. And they've already made it down to 2 RVs, you know, and that's too much. So anyway, we got a long road ahead of us with this RV living. This is not a good way to go in a rural area. That's all I got.
Okay. If anyone else was speaking, go ahead, ma'am. And again, make sure you identify your name for the record.
My name's Penny Lamb. I am the adjacent property to this proposal. And as Mr. McDonald said, I have lived in an RV park. I have lived in an RV almost 4 years in Idaho. These people do not know what they're getting into. The water freezes, the septic freezes, and if you try to heat it with anything but your furnace, you're running out of propane. I'm concerned for the people that think this is going to be a great thing. It's not a great thing. Living through the winter in an RV in Idaho requires a lot of work. And if these are people that are maybe elderly, they're retired, they don't have abilities to do things, who's going to do that for them? Who's going to shovel? Who's going to get under their trailer and thaw out their water? Who's going to do all these things? You know, I was always told, don't get emotional about this, but I am emotional about it. It's bordering on my property, and I'm going to have to watch these people go through this. And I'm not one that can stand by and watch. So I foresee having people at my house when they freeze up, which is fine. But I just think it's a bad idea for the area. When I lived in the RV park, it was in Post Falls. It was the Coeur d'Alene RV park, the very nice RV park. But I watched people go through a lot living there. And we also did. The water would freeze up. Septic would freeze up. You can wrap the water line, but you can't wrap the septic line enough to make it not freeze up underneath. It's just, it's awful living in an RV in the winter in Idaho. And we're even farther north than Post Falls. So I would ask that you consider that when you consider whether this is a good idea for this spot. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty. So what's your address if my water freezes up? Just kidding. That's actually very sweet of you, though.
I have next room.
Yeah, do you? Okay, sir, back in the back. There you go.
Hi, my name is Wade Kammer, and I'm a neighbor just down the road. And I would ask that you consider that context is important. So the development review process checks these details that have been addressed, and I support what's been said so far in opposition, but doesn't necessarily look at the big picture. And I would expect, I would ask that you guys take that mindset and look at this, that it is low-income housing, in the applicant's own words on the form. Not because the form said he had to write it that way, his own words in multiple places. And that's inconsistent with the zoning, the code, the character of the area, and I believe the intent of what was the code that is trying to be applied here, what that intent was. So I would ask that you guys seriously consider denying this. I appreciate your time.
Thanks, Whitney. Your last call. Anyone else? Seeing none. Let's go to staff first for rebuttal, then applicant, then we'll finish up with
Zoom.
Pardon?
Zoom. Yeah, good call.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. Yeah. Jen, is there anybody on Zoom?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Go ahead. Asia, you there? Asia? You're muted on your end. Can you unmute, please? Oh, really? Let's see who's next.
That's it.
That's it. Asia, can you hear us?
We can come back to her. You know, sometime if she's able to fix that problem.
Yeah, Asia, tell you what, we're gonna make sure let's make sure she stays unmuted, and that way if she is able to figure out what's going on, then we'll go ahead and let her jump in. But Asia, so we're gonna go ahead and just leave the line open. So if you get it figured out on your end, just pipe up and we'll take your testimony. Okay, now let's go to Daniel.
Commissioners, thank you. So a couple of concerns that came up, and the big one was adequate water and fire suppression. So the proposed RV park is within a fire district, which makes it adequate. If not, then nobody would be living in the Blanchard area, because I don't think anybody has any fire suppression that the fire department would use, even if they have a cistern sitting around or fire suppression. They've expressed that in other files as well. Back to the adequate water, I think it's a little subjective on that as to what it needs to be provided to possible tenants. That's not for me to decide which is adequate. But if we go to 12497,
hold on just a second.
Hey, we'll say, let him... I'll let you jump in after Daniel if we can hear you. What is that guy, that rapper? That... Go ahead.
Maxidrum.
Sorry.
Anyway, so 12497 letter G for water and sewer. Number one, each site may provide utility connections, including water and subsurface sewage disposal. So that's what it says.
I can hear you.
Keep going. Okay.
Muter for a second. Yeah.
So I think that addresses the water and the fire suppression portion of that. As far as the size of each space, the applicant has demonstrated that he's exceeding the code. He's proposed 2,700 square feet, where only 1,800 square feet is required for each space. And that's all I have. Thank you, commissioners.
Let's try. Do you have any questions for staff?
For clarification, when we talk about rural fire districts, they're just like ordinary fire engines that carry water.
They have a 10.
Right, 10-year so tenors or something.
Would there be any difference between carrying, accessing this site versus any other residential home that had a fire? That's kind of what we assume when we talk about.
Right. When they empty
almost all the rural areas of Blanchard County, we use a tender on if there's no fire hydrants.
I wanted to make sure I wasn't.
Right, and there's certain residents in Bonner County that just don't have access to a fire district. If you look at Upper Pack River Road, they're out of pretty much the whole road's out of a fire district.
So if this proposal was outside of a fire district.
It would not meet the standard. So if they were trying to propose this on Upper Pack River Road, it wouldn't meet that standard of having adequate fire because it's outside of the fire district.
And I think he's had a conversation with the chief also and can at least speak to, that's a minimum requirement. They can go beyond that. So
right, and that was the retired fire chief that made those calls.
Unless there's something submitted in writing.
Also had another conversation. conversation with that person that's claiming just the opposite, and there's really no way for us to gauge. There's no way for us to measure those. That's why
you wrote it in a comment.
Okay, any other questions for Daniel? Hey, thanks, Daniel. Let's see if we can go back to Asia now.
But you did allow, we did allow that person to report that that's what the discussion was. We didn't say that.
We choose not to consider it.
Weigh it or consider it. That's all. You can.
Right, but he can state it.
Yeah, sure, he can say whatever he wants.
Okay.
Up to you to decide how much weight to give.
Asia, can you hear us? What is that voice thing the rappers use sometimes? They do the voice. Hello, Asia. Asia,
I think it's her on a cell phone and I'm not a very good spot.
Who was the guy that's married to or dating one of the Kardashians? That's who
Kanye West.
Kanye West, there it is. Okay, Asia, one more shot. Can you hear us?
There you go. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
All right. Sorry, I messaged Jesse. I was on the phone because you're having a problem. So this is a significant increase in density in the Blanchard area. We're not an area that has city services. And this impact is, as it was explained a few times, that it's more of a long-term RV park, which means that you need services. And the idea of trying to address housing issues is great, but we're supposed to build in areas that have the services, which is not something that we have in Blanchard. This increased density, this is a small piece of acreage where you're potentially going to have 20 long-term homes living there without city services. And that's not what a conditional use permit is for. And regardless of the water issues that are valid here, that it seems like the commissioners are leaning towards will just get addressed later, it doesn't change the fact that this isn't a conditional use. This is an option for an increased density, which also puts the burden of that development on the area homeowners, because it's us who will have to pay for increased road issues. If I recall one of the hearings, the school did say there would be an issue if we were having buses go out to that area as well to pick kids up from school. So I don't think that this level of growth in Blanchard without services is appropriate in our area. And I think that the commissioner should look at what a conditional use permit is. This is just a way of having increased density to the cost actually of the people that are already in the area because of the way that this is happening. That's a lot of families. And I don't see in their plan any additional, there's a lot of things that they're hoping will get vetted out in the future, but there's a lot of concerns from the local people down here regarding having to absorb that impact. But alone, one of the rules of a conditional use permit requires that it has to mirror what the community looks like. And a year-round 20 RV park is not in line with the one home per 6 acres with an accessory building outline that's in our comprehensive plan. So I urge the commissioners to look at, is this really in line with the Blanchard non-incorporated area of Bonner County and what negative impacts that decision would have? I do think it's also reasonable to state with our water issue, you're potentially advertising to people that their needs will be met and they will have invested in this gentleman's property only to find out that we do have a water issue. And we do have an issue with that growth over the Rathdrum Prairie Aquifer as well in our community. It's not just the Blanchard area that would be affected by that level of impact. So I would request that you guys review that from the view of how much you're impacting the density in an unincorporated area without city services. Thank you.
Okay, now we'll go to the applicant for rebuttal if you have something you want to rebut.
Yeah, thank you.
So 83 minutes. It doesn't have to be a guessing game with water. It's already documented. An RV uses 125 gallons a day. That's the specs I'm having to meet with this my septic permit, 125 gallons a day. Now, most RV parks use way closer to 50 gallons a day per RV, but I can run the math. That's 83 minutes a day. That's less than an hour and a half a day to do the maximum, even that, which is probably closer to triple the amount of water I'd actually need using a 30 gallon a minute pump. Now, I had already planned on putting a water tank in the ground to help with fire suppression and stuff like that. And that we talked in length about this last time and about how strategic this property is designed to be able to fight fires. We have a road on the north, a road on the south. We have two roads in the center. We have access from the north, from the south. We can even, this is an old and existing driveway. You can access both rows of RVs from both sides and from both ends. It's one of the most strategically planned RV parks. One of the best designs you could have if you were trying to suppress a fire. You have roads everywhere blocking fire and allowing access. So the permit where I requested 90 gallons a minute for my water rights. Yeah, I'm requesting 90 gallons a minute. On that permit, that was the cheapest permit I could apply for. Over that, the permit price kept going up. So when I applied for my water rights, I got the cheapest permit knowing I didn't need very much water. And that cheapest permit ended up being 90 gallons. Now we can negotiate down from there. You're not allowed to negotiate up. I just went with the number of gallons on the cheapest permit when I paid for my permit. So that's where that number comes from. Also on the note of fire suppression, we have the plan calls for 20 water spigots. So we have water spigots every 30 feet. And like was pointed out, we also have went half again bigger on the sizes of each RV spot. We've doubled the distance required between RVs. It's 10 feet, I believe, and we're at 20 feet. So we've doubled that distance, and we've made the width of all the spots 6 feet wider. So we've made all spots far in excess of what the code requires. And as far as what the attorney on the opposing side was pointing out, he kept using the term dwelling units and this and permanent residence. None of those are mentioned in my permit. His adamant harping on the fact that dwelling units were not allowed there. I'm not talking about dwelling units. He's taken that from a different section of code and trying to apply that here. So this is the code for residential RVs that talk about two per property if you want to go the residential route. And that's where they're called dwelling units. The RV park code is 2 pages long because it's a lengthier code with a lot more restrictions. And they're not called dwelling units. So that's like an incorrect term to be using in here. It, nowhere in here is it called a dwelling unit, and nowhere in my permit is it called a dwelling unit. And we're talking about RV spots in an RV park. It's just kind of like ridiculous to take a term from another section of code talking about another situation. It doesn't make sense. Also, people talked about it being hard to back into these spots. We did the exact 45 degree angle that was required in the code. So the angle to back in here is actually specified in the code. And it's a 90 degree angle. I apologize, 45 degree angle. And that's what we're at. Our RV spots are at a 45 degree angle from the roadway, which is all specified. The width of our road is exactly 20 feet, exactly what the code specifies. A lot of the stuff we went over in length, like I said, we've gone through two hearings on this. So all of these issues have been hashed out. One of the hearings was ours, but we've went over a lot of this information in detail. So all of this stuff was hashed out, whether it was the fire district, the road width, verbiage, a lot of stuff was hashed out over the last two hearings. A lot of the arguments are more or less straw man arguments. They're putting up a fake image of what I'm trying to do and then attacking it. It's a classic argument style. We create this image using a lot of new words that aren't in it. We create an image of what somebody's doing, and then we attack it, and because it's now vulnerable. But that's a straw man argument. Most of the points they're trying to make just don't apply. And this was, like I said, unanimously approved. So anyhow.
What's the max length unit you can take?
I planned everything for 40-foot
RVs. And if you look closely, you can actually see I have representation of a 40-foot RV park rig.
Oh, okay, perfect.
So it is in here. It's hard to see in this picture. But I do represent, and that is the standard length of a car.
Give you a better sense of scale, too.
So. Yeah. Yeah, so all of this whole thing is built exactly to scale.
So with that, is there any other questions I can answer?
Any questions?
I'd be happy to answer.
Well, I got a hunch. Yeah, I'm going to have to because I got a hunch Norm possibly could run a little long. So
an attorney going long.
I need to pray.
Okay, then we'll go ahead and retire you and we'll recess for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
It's 3:38. We'll go ahead and recess for 5 minutes. Oh, really?
He played last year.
Yeah. That's cool.
Third grades are now in the third and fourth grade. League. So,
are they doing, is this tackle?
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Pads, everything.
Yeah. Matt McDonald.
Yeah.
He's his coach.
Okay. Yeah, we did. We played a bit. Yeah, here I coached. They had flag football.
And then we started tackling football since seventh grade.
Oh, really? No, we started. We started young. Might explain why my head is my brain's. We did flag football, and so flag football was pretty rudimentary. I was doing the third and fourth and fifth and sixth, and it was funny. I'm going, you know, run man of motion, so I had to go to the record. So I took the run man of motion. They said, the kids understand. I said, anything can do that. Because these kids would execute.
I've been surprised with them. Like, no, they have arguments. No, they have right. You know, dive right, counter right. Matt's coach. Yeah, last year, coach who had been high school coach forever.
Was it below?
Second gentleman was a
Lion.
Yeah, below.
That was super cool. Below is awesome. And below is a big fan of making sure it's fun at a young age.
So Matt's a little bit. Like, apparently, Matt yells a little more. That's when
Yeah, because it just started. Yeah, we had. I mean, we probably did have 40 plays. My guys could actually in fourth grade.
Right.
I mean, we had complex pass plays. It was cool. So we had funny. We did about having a little series. Had a couple of coaches. I get confidence. And we got to meet with a couple of coaches from the other team. Well, listen, you guys were running man football play. You said, "Yeah, I forgot to do that." But if you're with our players, I said, "You know, that's what I'm supposed to do." That's how football works. You come in and talk to the coaches. These guys, they'll be hard asses. Make it fun. They'll make sure you're pushing, but make sure it's fun.
Yeah.
But I also wanted to learn, so when they come out of this, they'll be even more prepared, and then when they get to high school, they'll be fully prepared. So we do some complex stuff. Flo and I get really good.
Interesting. That's why. Start the pipeline. Kids look like myself who got involved in it, you know, and like excited about it, you know. Then you start progressing through the grades, and that's when you get like, well-coached players with studs at good positions.
It's always luck of the draw if you get that horse.
Make sure it's the sun metals on, because there was like me, I got to look right at the so many years. My first 2 years of high school, I coached to go and get a class. And then I'm glad. Finally, they coached me to go.
I know he's overdue.
Okay, go ahead.
Even if you guys need to start back, let him go.
Okay.
Have a drink, Bill. You'll feel better.
Ready? Okay. It is 3:43. Yeah. 3:43, and we're back in session. So, Norm, it's your turn. You're up.
All right, commissioners, I guess I'm still where I started, and that is we've got to decide whether this is a proposal for an RV park or for RVs as dwelling units. And I understand the applicant's frustration when I talk about dwelling units, but that's the language in your code in section 332. Is this more like 12332, in which case it would be limited to 2 RV dwelling units per parcel living there? Or is it an RV park? This is the applicant's application. It has not been amended. It has not been changed. This is what they are proposing. This is what you would be approving, absent very stringent conditions that make it clear these are not dwelling units. These are not, in the words of the application, affordable housing or housing. It's an RV park. It's a commercial use where you rent spots out. It's got to be really clear because the application says our mission is to provide affordable housing for members of our community. Those are dwelling units. It's not an RV park. This is out of their application. They can't be upset at me for focusing on that. And then again, it says the park will provide transitional housing. Housing has a specific definition in your code, in law, and a low-income housing option for current residents. So again, this to us looks like, reading the application, it doesn't fit in the RV park box. It fits in the residential use box for single-family dwelling RVs. That's just straight out of the application, and your code has 2 spots, one for residential use and one for RV parks. Just calling it an RV park doesn't make it an RV park. I've got to respond to 12497G. Yeah, when you get to an RV park, you could provide the sufficient water through a utility connection. That's why it says may provide utility connections. That doesn't mean you don't have to provide water. Here, it's probably not going to be a water utility. It's going to be this well. And I still have not heard anything as to the exact amount of water that's going to be required for this. And there certainly has not been a water right approved for a commercial use of 20 homes. And I don't want to rehash that and just reiterate, I didn't hear anything that changed that observation. So thanks for your time. I was brief, almost beat Bill back from his water break.
Did good.
We always appreciate it for anybody's brief. Okay. I'm going to close to any further public comment, and we'll go ahead and start deliberation. So yeah, let's go through some of these things here. It is a conditional use permit. Yes, you want to say?
I do, because as you guys begin your deliberations, I always try to make sure that I point you to the standards that you have to meet, right? So we look at 12.223 in the what it talks about with the zoning commission, and therefore you guys looking at. Always start with adequate evidence showing that the proposal is in accordance with the comprehensive plan. That's always crucial. You guys can adopt that analysis from the staff report, but I always encourage you to discuss it too as you go through your deliberations. That's number one. You also have to look at the proposal, make sure that it's not going to be a hazard, or be dangerous to persons on or on the adjacent property. So I think that's all kind of included in the fire suppression and water and other stuff like that. But please keep those standards in mind so that we can have a good record. Thank you.
Okay, sure. So going back to where I was starting, it is a conditional use permit application. One of the folks testified against it said it should be a conditional use permit. It says it in large letters right on the top. It does say it's an RV park. I don't think there's any mystery as to what an RV park is versus a trailer park. This is an RV park. I think people got too hung up on year-round providing of RV parks, and I have actually stayed in RV parks during the winter, loving to stay there without water, and it was a non-issue. As far as need for services, if you own an RV, you know at least, and I'm going to guess at a number here, and it's probably not accurate, but at least 50% of these are in very remote rural areas on purpose. Some are in cities, some are around lakes, some are out in the middle of nowhere. Trust me, I've stayed in places in Montana that were just like a parking lot out in the middle of a field. So services aren't that big of an issue. I think you're close to being over the Rafton Perry aquifer, so that's going to help you with the well, because well, you sink a well out there and you've got plenty of water. So I don't think water is going to end up being an issue. However, that being said, we don't regulate water. We've got it in as one of the conditions. I think you outlined what the requirement was for RVs. I know I use probably around 30 gallons a day when I'm in my RV, when I'm boondocking. And what boondocking means is you're not hooked up to service. You're just out somewhere camped. So, I mean, it's not a lot of water, and most RVers are smart enough to know when and where they can camp, especially seasonally. Lake RV and Pond Ray, they have people there that camp all year long. They skirt their trailers. They've figured out how to make it. Not an issue. Respect to Betty, and I appreciate Betty. But even with the sewer, you never leave your gate open. When you're parked there, you wait, and when you get ready to leave, then you open the gate, because that's something if you're first time RVer, those are some of the rookie mistakes that get made, and I made it as well, but I learned from that. But I'm looking through this application and I'm looking through the letters, and I got to tell you, I hear the frustration in the applicant's voice. And I actually appreciate the fact that he stood up for himself, because I found a lot of the comments really unfortunate. I mean, I really did. I thought they were literally throwing things at the wall, hoping something would stick. Most of them were completely irrelevant, especially to the application and the overall operation of an RV park. The fact that his signs got stolen, I apologize for that. We didn't do it. I don't think you didn't do it. Steve didn't do it. So, but it's unfortunate that people treat others that way. It's not who Bonner County has ever been. Unfortunately, we have some new folks here that feel they want to change Bonner County and make it different. When looking at the application of the law, everything in here seemed to check all the boxes. I can understand why the zoning commission give you unanimous approval, because you do check all the boxes. You have done your due diligence. You provided more than what you were required to provide by code. And even so far as doing your due diligence, as we've said it already, if you can't get water, you can't get the water you need, you can't get sewer, then it's not going to go forward. But that's why this is a conditional use permit, because those are some of the conditions that are already outlined in the conditions. So looking at the comp plan, and what it says, and looking at our own ordinances, I think you're well within the parameters for approval. And so I lean heavily towards approving this.
And could you also comment on the fire suppression issue? And if you believe that's been adequately.
Yeah, so
you want to leave something for somebody else over here?
Well, I can, but you want to talk about fire?
I can.
Okay, go ahead.
So Dan covered a lot of it, and I think that the applicant did a good job of rebutting some of the comments that were made. It's unfortunate that we have to make these things personal. It seems to me that he's trying to do the best he can. He's trying to be a good neighbor. He's trying to address the concerns that the neighborhood had and the different people had that they brought forward. That was what he was trying to do, but yet people are assuming or making assumptions and statements that are pretty unfortunate, to the point of some of these letters are very derogatory. not towards him, but everybody that is less than what some people would expect them to be. That's unfortunate for Bonner County. There's always been a lot of people in Bonner County that have varying classes, and we welcome that because that's who we are in Bonner County. We welcome the people that have varying classes. And we appreciate the fact that not all of us are wealthy. We live within the means we get, and we do the best we can with what we have. That's who we are. I've lived here my whole life, so I don't really want to be told the way we should live, or I should live, or these people should live. So anyway, I'm going to get off my high horse and just go to the facts. The applicant made a very good point on how the fire suppression works with the dual roads on either side of these. I don't think you can get any better. I mean, you've got front side coverage and you got backside coverage. I don't know anybody else that can claim that in their area of, you know, fire suppression. So I think that all the fire concerns are met. If he's going to go beyond what the minimum requirements are, I think that's even better. Yeah, I think he's listened to concerns. He has plans for going beyond the minimum. If he doesn't, he only is required by law to meet the minimum. So, and I think he's done that. I know he's done that by what I read and what he spoke. And yeah, was that good enough on fire?
Sure. Okay. And even with respect to the concern over additional crime, if you ever bought an RV and then taken an RV down the road, typically it's not lower income people that are doing, that are having meth labs. Those things cost a lot of money. They cost a lot of money to operate. They cost a lot of money to maintain. The fuel prices the way they are. Good Lord, I've taken my own a few times this year, and I thought I was going to have to take a second on my house. So chances are, those people that own RVs are not going to be increasing crime. Chances are they're probably fine, upstanding folks who can afford the afford those RVs. Steve, go ahead.
Well, I just want to say, go a little further. I see some people saying, I wonder, you know, why is he even bringing that up? We're bringing these things up because this is what we read in the letters to the commission.
Yeah.
That's why we're bringing these things up. That's why we're trying to address the things that we read that are somewhat disturbing to myself.
I agree.
Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah, the fire thing, the perfect location. Great idea. You presented it well. I think you rebutted it well. The letters that come in, I think Jeff covered those. If you ever wanted another career, you might want to look at attorney. I think you'd make a good trial attorney. You shoot from the hip pretty darn good. And I like it.
Okay. Well, that being the case, I'll entertain a motion.
All right, I move to approve this project file CUP 0030-21, requesting a conditional use permit for an RV park, finding that it is in accord with the general and specific objectives of Bonner County Comprehensive Plan and Bonner County Revised Code, as enumerated in the following conclusions of law, and based upon the evidence submitted up to the time staff report was prepared and testimony received at this hearing. I further move to adopt the findings of fact and conclusions of the law as set forth in the staff report and direct planning staff to draft written findings and conclusions to reflect this motion, have chairman sign, transmit to all interested parties. This action does not result in taking of private property.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion, a second. Roll call vote. Aye.
Aye.
Aye, ma'am.
Motion passes and it's 350.